Welcome to our first Africa-China news discussion with China-Africa Project Managing Editor Eric Olander. Eric, good afternoon. I hope all is going well. Thank you so much for joining us on What Is This first show. You guys do an amazing newsletter. It comes out every day. For those who are not subscribed, please do check it out. And it's great. We've been following it carefully over the next 2 weeks. We'll be doing this again for the next couple of weeks. Bongiwe, likely my colleague, will do the next one, which will be right in FOCAC on the 29th of November. Eric, good afternoon.
Good morning to you, Barry. What a great honor to be here on the first episode of this discussion. Really excited to have the chat.
Thanks, Eric. All right, so we are right in the middle of FOCAC high season. It doesn't get much higher than this, Eric. But before we get into that, what I found just fascinating, what I find one of the most fascinating things about the Africa-China discourse is sort of the stuff that happens on the ground level, because you've got the men in suits business happening big time now. So the high-level stuff is FOCAC season. It's all about meetings and all kinds of deals, all kinds of things. But then you still have this ongoing patchwork of just the most amazing stories happening on ground level. So for example, in Uganda, and I'm just touching on a couple here very quickly to give a sort of a taste of this, but five Chinese nationals, all surnamed Chin, so there's probably a family something business going on here. All five of them traveled from China to Uganda to attack a Chinese businessman, and they were all arrested. Isn't that a crazy story?
I mean, that's just the backdrop of everything that's going on. Is there's so much, I mean, everybody focuses on the big summits and the big meetings and the policy and the foreign policy. But as you pointed out, there are countless of these stories that just happen every day across the continent.
Yeah, the other one was the interesting one in Ghana, where a local Chinese mall found itself, it got to work one morning early and found a huge amount of boulders dumped in front of the mall, which happened to be, as it turns out, competition from a competing Ghanaian mall or some local mall land.
The mall next door, in fact. They said that the China mall was encroaching on their property.
Right.
So that they thought the best solution, after warning them repeatedly, was to drive a big dump truck full of massive boulders and put it right in front of the parking lot so nobody could go in. Yeah. So that was entertaining, no doubt.
That was great. All right. So FOCAC. So we know it's happening 28 to 30 November. Interesting one about this, Eric, is that it's only happening at the ministerial level, but we have seen with this China FOCAC Africa high season of media coverage, there's some interesting things happening, right? There was a very prominent discussion on Chinese television with an academic and an interviewer about what's happening with China's relationship with Africa. We've seen Chinese ambassadors fanning out across the continent, doing interviews, discussing this, publishing stuff. And then this Professor Zhang Weiwei from Fudan University, he sort of put this very succinctly. You know, he was saying basically what China is offering to Africa is economic development. To put it at its most simple form, we are here to develop Africa. We give Africa the opportunity for economic development. And on the side of that, you've got then the Belt and Road happening, right? And the Belt and Road happening in its various sort of iterations. You've got the digital Silk Road happening, right? You've got the maritime Silk Road happening. You've got then this infrastructure belt sort of happening. You've got other things happening, like China had a big meeting last week on Africa with the Beidou system, the cooperation forum. So that's another really interesting things going on. There's the, as I mentioned, the Silk Road initiative, and you know, all these things are a part of FOCAC now. So there's a lot of things happening. But Eric, what will you be looking for in this FOCAC? What's going to be the story here with this one? We know that this is a ministerial one, so it's not a summit. The Xi Jinping himself will not be there. But what will you be looking out for this year's FOCAC?
I think the fact that it's not a summit in some ways may actually be helpful, because at the ministerial level, it's much more focused on results and just getting stuff done. Whereas if you had the summit, you'd have all the pomp and the circumstance. And I think this is a moment right now, given where we are in the global economy, given where we are with the pandemic, that the focus is actually on getting stuff done and doing things rather than pomp and circumstance, to me seems more fitting. Okay, a couple things that we're going to be looking for out of FOCAC. Number one is, you know, against this question of, is China going to change course from previous FOCAC? So 2015, it was 20 billion. No, I'm sorry. 2012, it was $20 billion. 2015, it was $60 billion. 2018, it was another $60 billion. Mm. Will China come with a big, giant check and say, this is our financial commitment, this is our package? There is a lot of good guesswork that says, yes, they will. It may be a repackaging of different numbers that they've already kind of put together. Remember that China's economy today is not the same that it was 5-10 years ago. It's not anywhere near as strong in some respects. They've got a lot of headwinds at home. They've got a slowing economy at home. Xi Jinping's under pressure to make sure he can deliver power, make sure that he can, you know, the transition to the new party plenum that's coming up next year is very, very critical as well. And the perception that China is giving away, and that's the perception, even though most of the money in these FOCAC pledges are in the form of loans. So it's not giving away, it's not grants, but in the Chinese perception is they see a 60 billion number, they say, why are we giving this money to Africa when we need it at home? And there is some truth to it that they need it at home because of the changing economy right now. So number one, is China going to give this big giant check? Number two that we're looking for, is China going to shift tack a little bit and change their approach in terms of these big infrastructure projects? We all know, and you in South Africa know it better than anybody right now, with the load shedding and Eskom and the nightmare that you've been having to deal with, the need for infrastructure is bottomless right now. And the difficulty in securing financing is also very, very challenging. Where does Africa go if China pulls out of the large-scale infrastructure financing? The other thing that we're going to be looking for, and this is the last point that I'll make on this, is these new projects. You talked about the Digital Silk Road. There's the Green BRI. And what we're probably going to see more of now are these smaller, more targeted projects, projects in the tens of millions of dollars and the hundreds of millions of dollars, but not the billions of dollars. So these are telecommunications networks. These are small power stations. These are solar power plants in the 10 megawatt, 50 megawatt, rather than 500-600 megawatt. They're not the big coal power plants and whatnot. And so that's going to be the what we'll be looking for on that front as well. Okay. Small targeted infrastructure rather than big giant roads, ports, and bridges.
It's going to be interesting to see how it goes. When in our next discussion in 2 weeks, we might have a better idea of this. All right. So at this, on the side of this, Eric, what's been happening as well is this thing called Build Back Better World Partnership, right? So this has now been something happening on an entirely different level. I mean, we saw that Joe Biden at COP20, he mentioned it without even mentioning China. And we have seen also reports from Chinese officials kind of dismissing this. So there is the B3W. So there is a little bit of tension related here, obviously. And this is an American competitor coming in here. Well, it's interesting that that they framed it. If you look at how the B3W is framed, it says very clearly that this is going to be aimed at countries with democratic values front and center. They've already identified 50 projects, and this apparently was also working with the G7 as well. So just quickly, Eric, while we're talking about FOCAC and then we're talking about this one, do you think at any point this could become a feasible competitor to the BRI?
And this is the problem that the United States has, is by trying to frame this as some kind of competitor, it sets itself up for defeat in some respects, because then people are just going to measure what's the output of BRI and what's the output of B3W, rather than introducing it as something new and something different, which it is in a lot of respects, because B3W plans to use private sector capital. It plans to be more transparent. It plans to be the anti-Belt and Road, okay? And by the way, this week, just as we're recording this, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken is starting a week-long tour of Africa, three African countries. He's going to go to Kenya, Nigeria, and to Senegal, all countries with strong Chinese presences, by the way. B3W will likely be a very prominent topic of conversation. Dalip Singh, who is the Deputy U.S. National Security Advisor, was just in Senegal last week or a week before, and he concluded B3W talks as well. So we're looking at the first investments in Africa will probably be in Senegal or Ghana. The question is the United States government set up to do this kind of thing? The United States government is a very sprawling, discombobulated bureaucracy. It doesn't function well at the way that the Chinese do, which is far more centralized, where it can mobilize state capital, state enterprises, and then policy and put that together. The U.S. isn't able to do that. That's challenge number one. So they're going to have to move quickly. And basically what I said was that the moment that B3W is officially launched, okay, so the moment that they say, and this is supposed to be next January, there's going to be an hourglass that flips. And people are going to look to see how quickly can Americans deliver these projects. because the Chinese can put projects, shovels into the ground within 18 months, 12 to 18 right. months. They can move fast. And people are going to compare what can the US do in terms of time and speed. And all of this, again, this is what's challenging here. All of this emphasis on high quality, on stakeholder engagement, on open transparency, you know, in African politics, that oftentimes opens up for a lot more discussion, a lot more complication, a lot more corruption, a lot more difficulty quite a bit. So while the backdoor way that the Chinese do in the back room with the elites is not preferable in terms of transparency and good governance, it is preferable in some sense of getting projects done quickly sometimes, right. in some instances. Right. So we're going to see how quickly can the Americans move, because if the Americans take 3 to 5 years to build a road, well, that's not going to be very impressive, and most people won't see that as a as an initiative. Last thing to point out on this is that, you know, we have a very complex American political system, and we're going into a season now of a very contentious politics in the United States. And the tradition in the United States now, recent tradition, is that when an opposing party wins the presidency, they throw out everything from the predecessor. Mm. So Trump threw out everything from Obama, Biden threw out everything for the most part from Trump, or a lot of it. And so will B3W survive if Biden or the Democrats lose the White House? Lots of people in Africa are a little bit concerned about getting too invested in B3W until they know that this thing actually has some durability to it.
Right. One can see that it could sort of get easily get sort of bogged down somewhere.
Yeah.
Let's quickly look at a couple of other issues. So the DRC, where to begin, where to end? The news this week.
Complicated.
Chinese gold mining companies admitted environmental damage from their operations in the DRC, but they say they want to bounce back. They want to get back in the game. There's been a lack of progress with the Sikomini's deals. One of the DRC ministers came out this week and said there's been lack of progress. There was a lack of planning. To top all that, we've seen that there's terrible conditions apparently at five of the largest cobalt mining companies in the DRC, which include Chinese cobalt mining companies. So the DRC is carrying out a big review of Chinese logging and mining companies, and there was a new Sikomini's video, whether it was actually legitimate or not. Well, there's another one.
Not going on.
It's just kind of amazing. So, Eric, is it going so bad for the China and the DRC?
Well, I think that's one way of reading it, that it's going so bad. I'm not convinced it's going that bad for the Chinese. First, let's look at these issues. We have to divide them into two pieces here. One is the what you talked about, which are these gold mining companies. Those are the unregulated, informal gold mining or mining companies that operate in South Kivu in the Far East, okay? And that is an endemic problem right now out in the Far East. It's not only in South Kivu, it's also in Ituri, it's also in Lualaba, it's in a number of the different Far Eastern provinces. And those are largely unregulated. There's a lot of corruption in that. They are not part of these big state-owned enterprises. These are just small Chinese mining companies that see an opportunity in the eastern DRC to mine gold and other minerals and metals, and they extract it. So there's been a crackdown on the part of the South Kivu provincial governor. This is what's being now kind of disputed in Kinshasa, and that's what you referred to as they want to make a comeback and they want to come back. We don't quite know yet, but this is a tension between Kinshasa and South Kivu. Now, on the big state-owned mining companies, that's another one that's in Kinshasa about these contracts, Sikomines. This is TFM, China Moly, CMNC. These are the big players in the cobalt and the copper sector. And the report that came out that was very interesting about the difficulty that workers are having there is not workers for the actual mines. They are the subcontractors. And those subcontractors are the ones that are reporting lots of difficulties. Now, subcontractors in a lot of countries report difficulties, but in the DRC, three of the five that this UK NGO identified as being Chinese, and that's not surprising given that Chinese companies account for 60% of the output of cobalt, for example, from the DRC. Now, in terms of the politics of all this, I come down a little bit as a contrarian here, which is that, and I told this in an interview with the BBC, that at the end of the day, this is about Chesikedi, who's the president, recognizing a couple of different things. One, he needs the Chinese companies on his side for his reelection campaign that will kick off in January in earnest. And the presidential campaign will happen in 2023. He needs the infrastructure that the Chinese are building as part of these deals. And what he saw was that the Chinese were not living up to their commitments. And back in May, he went to Sycomines and he gave this really important speech where he read them the Riot Act. And remember, all politics at the end of the day is local. And again, so a lot of people interpreted that saying, look at Chesikedi, he's cracking down on the Chinese. Yes, he was cracking down on the Chinese. But at the end of the day, he also wanted the infrastructure that he could run on. And this is something that one of his predecessors, Joseph Kabila, did as well with the Cinq Chantiers, the five construction projects. And so he pushed him to do that. And now we are seeing the fruits of that. The Chinese are kicking up their construction initiatives. And at the end of the day, he also wanted to set these contracts straight because they were largely unfair. What we know from the research is that the Congolese under Kabila who negotiated these contracts didn't really read them. A lot of the contracts were in Chinese. And it was a sense that there wasn't the due diligence that was needed because certain people got paid. And that was kind of more or less enough back then. And Chesikedi recognized that and he wants to set that straight. He also sees that cobalt has a finite value right now because automakers around the world are very anxious to rely both on the Congo, which has very shady supply chain kind of oversight. Oftentimes about 10 to 20% of the cobalt that comes out of the Congo is artisanal cobalt, and that oftentimes, or artisanally mined, and that oftentimes involves child labor or substandard labor practices. And then about 80 to 90% of the cobalt that is processed comes out of China. And so the combination of those two makes a lot of international automakers very, very worried that it's not a good idea to rely on Congolese cobalt. So now we're looking at iron, sodium, lithium, all these are different metals and different ways to power batteries that don't rely on Congolese cobalt. And so Chesikedi is seeing this and he says, I may have 5, maybe 10 years left that this commodity has enormous value. This is the time to restructure these deals to get a bigger chunk of that money and a bit more leverage. So he's squeezing the Chinese. And for the most part, my reading of the situation is that the deals are already done, that the deals have been done in the back channels. We don't see too much pressure right now. He's basically slow walked what his ministers are saying in these Council of Minister reports that you referred, that he asked his infrastructure minister and his mining minister to give two reports. The infrastructure minister said, you know what, the Chinese aren't living up to what they promised. My guess is it's pretty easy for the Chinese to kick up a little bit more money to produce some more infrastructure. But Chesikedi, he needs to get this Chinese mining issue behind him because he wants to focus and he needs to focus on the campaign. And already just over the weekend, there were riots in Kinshasa over some of the electoral politics decisions that he's making. He's got a lot of, politics in Kinshasa, and I used to live there, is a contact sport. And he can't be distracted by dealing with these Chinese mining contracts. He needs the Chinese on his side to fund the infrastructure and to fund his campaigns. And so my guess is that this deal is done for the most part. Things are settling down and the Chinese will continue to mine. The infrastructure will be built and things kind of go on as they are, as you know. And again, the Congo is a complicated, confusing place for that kind of stuff. Mm.
That is a complicated picture. That's interesting.
It is. It is a complicated picture.
Yeah. Let's quickly look at Kenya. So we've heard this week that Kenyans are saying that Nairobi is a Chinese construction site. It probably looks a lot similar to Addis, where you see just everywhere, you see this particularly Chinese style of construction sites they're just everywhere. It's probably similar in Nairobi. So what's, this thing with the infrastructure and the new Nairobi Expressway, that apparently there will be no minibuses allowed on it, which is, this being Kenya, is kind of...
Batutu buses, those are they're small. It'll have the big buses, but not the small minibuses on it.
It's a bit of a strange decision then. And also it's going to be having expensive tolls. So that issue is happening. We know that Kenya still has an issue with debt ongoing. They've been having discussions with the G20. That apparently didn't go well. African Development Bank issued a warning on Kenyan debt. On top of that, we now see that Kenya is the largest hub in Africa for laundering the proceeds of illegal wildlife tracking, logging, and fishing. and there was some Chinese illegal businesses closed down this week. So there's a lot of things happening in Kenya, also a very complicated picture. I'm just starting to wonder, Eric, if this big SGR, these big construction projects, considering the huge problems with debt and other issues, is it really going to be, is it really worthwhile for Kenya, do you think, from the current vantage point?
It depends. So let's again separate some of these issues. So the Nairobi Expressway, that is 27 kilometers, $500 million, goes from Jomo Kenyatta International Airport right through central Nairobi. It's the largest construction project of its kind since the SGR, which then was the largest construction project in post in post-independence. So these are big construction projects, but the Nairobi Expressway is a very important experiment, not just for Kenya, but for all of Africa and China. This is a public-private partnership. So the China Road and Bridge Corporation is putting up all of the money to build this. This will not add to Kenya's debt. And that's a very important milestone. And again, they're looking for new ways to finance infrastructure. Now, the CRBC, the China Road and Bridge Corporation, is going to recoup that money through toll fees on the Nairobi Expressway. And this has been a point of contention here, because there might be flexible pricing on this depending on the value of the shilling versus the dollar. So for example, if the shilling changes in value, they may have to increase the price of the toll fee to compensate for the depreciation of the shilling. This is something that makes people very, very nervous, because all of a sudden you go on a Tuesday and it's, you know, one price, you go back on Wednesday and it's another price, and it's very expensive.
And then
there's this other concern that it's going to be it's going to exacerbate the wealth inequity in Kenya, where the wealthy and the rich will be able to go on the fast expressway, and everybody else will be relegated to the road below, which is, you know, slow, and the matutus and all the other kind of the minibuses and the taxis and all the ways that people kind of get around. And what it is rather than thinking about a holistic transportation solution, the concern that a growing number of analysts have is that this is not a solution. This is just one part of a solution, but they haven't been thinking of it in terms of how do you make the whole network work more efficiently and better. And that's been one of the concerns there. So that's on the roads, on the expressway side. But on the SGR side, again, this is how you, it depends on how you look at it. And we're starting to see this really nice integration between the SGR, the new special economic zone that's building up around, you know, the Port of Mombasa. Trade coming in from the Port of Mombasa is putting cargo more and more onto the SGR, going out to Naivasha. Naivasha in the Rift Valley, which is the endpoint of the SGR, was originally, under the original blueprint, supposed to be the gateway into Uganda and other parts of East Africa. The Kenyans could not persuade the Chinese to fund those latter stages. But what they've done now is, from Kampala and from Uganda, they've brought the old meter gauge railway to Naivasha. And so what we're starting to see now is this kind of putting together this jigsaw puzzle of meter gauge, which is the old colonial gauges, with standard gauge railways. So Tanzania is building a standard gauge as well. And we're going to start seeing this network of rail crisscross East Africa, which has always been the dream. It's just not happening the way that people thought, which is, one, all standard gauge, and two, it would be all built by the Chinese and financed by the Chinese. It's what the Tanzanians are using standard charter to help finance some of their construction. The Ugandans also are finding alternative sources to finance their railway construction. But this is what we need, especially with the advent of the Africa Continental Free Trade Area, is the ability to move goods and products across borders in Africa is going to be even more important. And so the standard gauge could potentially play a very important role in getting goods to Mombasa and whatnot. There's still a lot of competition with truckers in Kenya who are still not happy about this. Taxpayers are not happy with this. But this kind of infrastructure, and I always remind people, critics in the West, that this kind of infrastructure never pays for itself. I mean, in Germany, in France, in the United States, in Japan, they continue to subsidize their rail networks by the tens of billions every year. And so to put the burden on somehow that Kenya is supposed to make its railway profitable in the first 2 to 5 years is kind of absurd in some respects. Can it lead to greater economic activity that generates the needed tax revenue that will then lift the whole economy and repay those loans? That's the question, and it's still too early to answer.
Yeah, those are the sort of things that take time, really. That's a
These are generational projects.
Exactly.
So we're too early in this to be able to conclude it.
Eric, quickly, I wanted to chat to you about 8Data. So the we had the 8Data report that was released a few months ago, which they, according to their data, they said that the BRI causes hidden debts, it has labor and environmental issues. There was predictably a response from Chinese state media, who Global Times from Beijing called the report full of holes and errors, like distorted data, confusing concepts, misinterpretation, and unfounded assumptions. That's what they said. Those are the words.
Well, that's what you expect Global Times to say.
Yeah. But there was this interesting riposte from Chinese academia this week, Justin Lin and Yan Wang. They actually, from their point of view, reinterpreted the 8Data data, if I'm correct, please correct me if I'm wrong here. And they said that actually, no, it doesn't. It's not the other side. The picture is, the glass is actually much more than half full, because actually this data was good for, according to their interpretation of the data, China was good for 78 positives for dealing with bottlenecks. It actually had a 78% success rate for dealing with bottlenecks. So, Eric, the question to you is, how can journalists navigate opposing views of what is possibly the same, likely the same data? How do you navigate opposing views of that?
Well, what's so frustrating for me every time that we interview Brad Parks from 8Data is I go into the interview having done the research by reading the Financial Times, the Washington Post, the Guardian, the mainstream, even the mainstream African press, thinking that I understand what the story is. And this has happened on numerous occasions. And then you talk to Brad Parks at 8Data, and he tells you something totally different. He gives you the nuance, the detail. These are really complicated stories, generally speaking. And I'm not trying to side here with Global Times, and all of those people. I'm trying to point out that too often they will pick up on the one big negative headline. So the big negative headline out of the latest 8Data report was the fact that there is all this hidden debt. And what's interesting is, again, that was certainly part of what 8Data reported, but it was a small part of what they reported. Yeah. What the pair that you recommended, so Yan Wang and Justin Yifu Lin, they found that there was in the data a lot more positive information. And Brad Parks will give you a much more detailed analysis of that. We did a full interview with Brad, which I highly recommend. And at the end of these interviews, I'm always like, holy crap, this was not the story at all that I thought. Now, to the controversy about the 8Data and the hidden debt. So this was the story that Global Times was responding to, was also the fact that the team at the China Africa Research Initiative, led by Professor Deborah Brautigam, she's took another look at the data, and she had a very constructive critique about what 8Data was doing in terms of how they classified some of these hidden debts. And some of it was joint venture money that they then assigned entirely to China, when in fact some of that money belonged with the joint venture holder in the African country. And so that big hidden debt number, according to Deborah Brautigam and the China Africa research team, wasn't anywhere near as big and was overstated, and according to them, distorted the conversation. I prefer to look at some of the other issues in this, because I think these sensational negative narratives, which oftentimes drive it, and I say negative narratives only in the sense that those are very appealing in terms of what a lot of people in some countries want. But again, these stories are far more complex and nuanced.
But that just tells you, we're always bedeviled by the soundbite and the headline. Always bedevils a really interesting story on really interesting data like this to really understand the import and the full picture of this. It's better,
it's really hard.
Rather listen to a podcast or check out the data for yourself than to sort of participate in this kind of, what's the word, sort of sensationalist
and also the
media
fact
reporting.
Yeah, it's very lazy media reporting in many respects. And I get I'm in this very deep, so I kind of see it from a different angle. But when I see FT, the Bloomberg, and all of the main news kind of going with one simple part of it, which again, it tends to be negative. And again, I'll give you another example of this that's going on right now. And this is what I've been writing about today, is that, for example, the United States put forward in its latest, the U.S. military put forward again in its latest report for the Pentagon, for Congress, that the Chinese are planning to build another military base, and they're considering four countries in Africa to do that. But they haven't provided any evidence. This is a long-standing narrative, and people just kind of run with it as if it's a truth. And again, I'm not saying it's not happening, but the U.S. has to provide the evidence. But that negative narrative is so appealing. And so it's just, you know, it's unfortunate because it does mask the nuance that's needed and better understanding the China-Africa relationship.
Eric, last couple of points before we close. Buses. There's interesting story, some interesting interlocking stories about Chinese buses in Africa. We've seen that Woolworths in South Africa are now going to use SAIC electric vans, which are Chinese electric vans. We know that in Zimbabwe, Chinese buses are now going to be used for public transport. We've seen BYD actually is going to be manufacturing electric buses in Kenya. So interesting little thematic issue there.
Yeah, there's buses and there's a lot in the electric new energy vehicle mobility space in Africa is wide open right now. So BYD has also opened its first retail location in Zimbabwe, selling its new Blade vehicles. There's also this great startup in Kenya, in Ghana, called Solar Taxi, that's importing BYD and other EVs, and then they're creating all of these kind of rental and sales and service. You talked about what's happening in Kenya right now, where they're importing BYD electric buses, and they're going to create whole fleets of electric buses for use for charters and for urban transportation. And then Woolworths as well. The EV space for the Chinese, I think they look at this almost less as a automotive space and more like a consumer electronics cell. And the Chinese are very strong in consumer electronics. They had to play catch up on in the automotive sector because they were 100 years behind the Germans and the Americans and Henry Ford and all of these. But in the EV space, everybody almost starts at zero because the technology is so new. Right. And the Chinese are able to build high quality consumer electronics in many respects that are really well suited for the developing world. So we've seen, for example, in Africa, Transsion has about 50 to 60% of the feature phone in the smartphone markets. And I think you're going to see the same dynamic in the automotive sector. We look at, I'm doing a story this week on Great Wall Motors, Chery. These are all brands that people outside of China don't know that well. But these brands in South Africa, for example, some of them, the Havilon, I think it's Great Wall Motors, is one of the top rated SUVs now and top selling SUVs.
The FAW truck in South Africa has been very successful.
And that's built in South Africa too. And so they're actually moving in Morocco, and they're building a Chery as wants to set up, I think, in Kinshasa. There's a lot of manufacturing going on in the automotive sector from the Chinese as well. So that's an industry and a sector to watch, not just in the internal combustion side, but also in the EV side. And then all the new businesses that young African entrepreneurs are leveraging, but using Chinese EV technology. That to me is super exciting. So keep an eye on Solar Taxi. And I think it's called Bazigo in Kenya, which is the bus story as well.
Okay, Eric, so just before we go to the close, just one thing I wanted to mention, which was a really interesting story that came out during the last 2 weeks, but I think we just mentioned it. We're not going to go into it. It's really a very complicated issue. But apparently that there was the story about China is reducing fuel subsidies for its distant fishing fleet.
Yeah.
So we know that this is a highly complicated issue. I mean, we've seen stories about Chinese vessels going into places like Cameroonian waters, and then there's trouble with local. It's not just the Chinese vessels going in there doing something. It's actually some local officials on the Cameroon side being involved with this. So it's a highly complicated issue, and we can maybe discuss that more in the future. But that was an interesting story, that I think this might have an impact on those distant fishing fleets, because we've seen stories that actually they go to so many places around the world.
Yeah, they do, and they're very big players. The Chinese distant fishing fleet in Africa is very, very important. So they're very active in the Gulf of Guinea and off of coast of Ghana. They're active off the coast of Mozambique. They're active. They're pretty much active in most of the main coastal fishing waters. The difficulty about this news is there's good news and there's bad news. So the good news is they're reducing some of the subsidies. The bad news is they've increased the amount of opacity and the lack of transparency. So it's harder to actually monitor what they're doing with the distant fishing fleets. But it's one of those areas where the interests of the Chinese fishing fleets, you know, correspond with some of the interests of the governing elites in countries like Ghana, who would prefer to take the money rather than to actually crack down on it. We've spoken repeatedly with civil society groups who work in the coastal fishing communities off of Ghana. And year after year after year, they say that the government doesn't do anything to crack down. Everybody knows what the Chinese are doing here, and they're just not doing anything about it. And by the way, just to be fair, while the Chinese are a dominant player in this space, they are by no means alone. European distant fishing fleets, who also receive subsidies, are active there. The Japanese are active in some of these waters. So they're by no means alone. But what we understand from speaking to activists in this space is that the Chinese are on a much different scale than the others.
Eric, thank you so much. That was just excellent talking to you about all these issues happening. Just to close, for the next 2 weeks, what are we going to look? What are we looking out for? Obviously, the main story is FOCAC.
This is something that happens only once every 3 years. So it is as important as it gets. And again, it's going to be interesting to see, you know, how much commitment does China put towards Africa in terms of money and resources and whatnot. Also, we'd like to see, you know, how well African negotiators have kind of aligned some of their interests. This has been the big demand, is that Africa works together more as a block. And if it's not a continental block, it could be a regional bloc, that ECOWAS, you know, the ECOWAS countries or the EAC or the SADC countries, you know, negotiate with China for some enhancements and for things like that. So we're going to be looking for that to see what comes out of it. We're going to be looking to see, is Africa still important to China? And there's a very credible case to be made that says economically, Africa is not that important to China. This is a continent that does about $187 billion last year of trade. This year is probably forecasting it closer to $200 billion. Now, that sounds like a lot for China, and it sounds like a lot for Africa. It's a lot more than the United States at $32.5 billion, certainly. But for China, which is the largest trading power in the world, $4.23 trillion of trade it did last year, $200 billion is really just a drop in the bucket. So economically speaking, the quantities are not large, but is, you know, Africa important politically? Is it important sociologically? Is it important in terms of, you know, geopolitics, diplomacy, all these other areas? And we'll get a temperature check on that with FOCAC.
Yeah, it's interesting to see how Africa, when it comes to interest from China, has for various reasons always punched above its weight. And we'll see how that's going to continue. Anyway, Eric, thank you so much. That was great.
Thank you.
We'll be talking again in 2 weeks. So please look out for that next episode. Eric, thank you. And we'll see you around about FOCAC time.
That sounds great. See you then. Thanks.
All right. Cheers.